Guardiola, Another Way of Winning, The Biography, by Guillem Balague, read by William Glasswell. To my brother Gustavo, Coulé. My sister Yolanda, newborn Coulé. Luis Miguel Garcia, who will never be Coulé. And Brent Wilkes, who reminds us constantly, football is not about life and death. Foreword by Sir Alex Ferguson. I missed out on signing Pep Guardiola as a player back at the time when he realised that his future no longer lay at Barcelona. Although there wasn't any apparent reason for him to leave his club, we spoke to Guardiola and I thought I had a good chance of getting him. Maybe the timing I chose was wrong. It would have been interesting. He was the kind of player that Paul Scholes developed into. He was captain, leader, and midfield playmaker in Johan Cruyff's incredible Barcelona dream team, and displayed a composure and ability to use the ball and dictate the tempo of a game that made him one of the greatest players of his generation. Those were the kind of qualities I was looking for. I ended up signing Juan Sebastian Ferran for that reason. Sometimes you look back at a really top player and you say to yourself, I wonder what it would have been like if he'd have come to United. That is the case with Pep Guardiola. I can understand Pep's situation as a player. When you're at a club like Barcelona, you would like to think you have a place for life. So when we approached him, he probably thought he still had a future at the club, even though he ended up leaving that season. It is a shame, because nothing is for life in football. Age and time catch up with you, and the day comes when both you and the club have to move on. At the time, I thought we were offering Pep a solution, a different road in his career, but it didn't work out. It reminds me of Gary Neville. Having Gary at Manchester United since he was 12 years old, he became almost like family, like a son, someone you depend upon and trust, who was part of the whole structure of the team. But one day, it all finishes. In Pep's case, the realisation that all that was coming to an end must have been difficult. I could understand his doubts, his delay in committing, but it got to a point where we had to look somewhere else, and that opportunity disappeared. One thing I have noticed about Guardiola, crucial to his immense success as a manager, is that he has been very humble. He has never tried to gloat. He has been very respectful. And that is very important. It is good to have those qualities, and looking back, it is apparent that he has been unassuming throughout his career. As a player, he was never the type to be on the front pages of the papers. He played his game in a certain way. He wasn't tremendously quick, but a fantastic, composed footballer. As a coach, he is very disciplined in terms of how his team plays. But whether they win or lose, he is always the same elegant, unpretentious individual. And to be honest, I think it is good to have someone like that in this profession. However, it seems that he reached a point in his coaching career where he was conscious of the importance of his job at Barcelona while experiencing the demands attached to it. I am sure he spent time thinking, how long is it going to last? Will I be able to create another title-winning team? Will I be able to create another European Cup-winning team? Can I maintain this level of success? If I had arrived in time to advise him, I would have told Pep not to worry about it. A failure to win the Champions League is not an indictment of his managerial abilities or of his team. I understand the pressure, though. The expectation was so high every time Guardiola's team played, everyone wanted to beat them. In fact, I think he was in a fortunate position in a way, because the only thing he had to worry about was how he was going to break down the opposing team to stop them winning. Personally, I think it's about keeping going. So why go? It might be a question of controlling the players, of finding new tactics, because teams have started working out Barca's style of play, or a question of motivating them. In my experience, a normal human being wants to do things the easiest possible way in life. For instance, I know some people who have retired at 50 years old. Don't ask me why. So the drive that most people have is different from that of individuals like Scholes, Giggs, Xavi, Messi and Puyol, who, as far as I am concerned, are exceptional human beings. And motivation is not an issue for them because their pride comes before everything. I'm sure Pep's squad was full of the types of characters who were an example to others and a source of motivation, not types who wanted to retire too early. I know Gerard Piqué from his time here at United. I know his type of personality. Off the pitch, he can be a laid-back, easy-going guy, but on the pitch, he is a winner. He was a winner here, and we didn't want the boy to leave, and he's a winner there at Barcelona. The players Pep had under him needed less motivation than most. Perhaps Pep underestimated his motivational abilities. You could see what he consistently achieved with that Barcelona team, and you need to have a special talent to keep them competing at that level and with such success for so long. But I am convinced he has enough weapons to do it again, and again, and again. What Guardiola achieved in his 4 years at the first team of Barcelona betters anything that previous coaches at the Camp Nou have done. And there have been some great ones, Van Gaal, Rijkaard and Cruyff to name a few. But Guardiola has taken certain areas to another level, such as pressing the ball. And Barcelona's disciplined style of play and work ethic have become a trademark of all his teams. Pep created a culture where the players know that if they don't work hard, they won't be at the club. Believe me, that is not easy to do. Whatever Pep's next move may be, after he has taken some time out, whether he moves to the Premier League or not, there's always going to be a lot of speculation surrounding his future. He was at a fantastic football club at Barcelona, and it is not going to get any better for him wherever he goes. Going to another club will not take any pressure off him or reduce the level of expectation surrounding him. In fact, wherever he goes, he is going to have the same experience. He is a manager. He has to decide what is best for his team, about choosing players and their tactics. It is that simple. In that respect, it is the same wherever you go, because all managers' jobs come with pressure. I've been successful at Manchester United for many years, and it's not without its problems. Every hour of every day you have to deal with something. It comes down to the fact that you are dealing with human beings in the world of football. There's a plethora of things to worry about: agents, family, form, injuries, age, profile, ego, etc. If Pep were to go to another club, the questions would be the same as those he has faced so far. The expectation would follow him around. So why? Why would he decide to leave? When you asked me before Pep announced his decision, I did say that it would be silly not to see the job through. If you look at Madrid, who won 5 European Cups in the late 50s and early 60s, there's no reason to think that he couldn't have done the same with Barca. That, to me, would be a personal motivation if I had that team. And if I were Pep, leaving would have been the most difficult decision to make. Sir Alex Ferguson, Spring 2012. Rome, 27th of May 2009, UEFA Champions League final. It is the 8th minute of the match, Barcelona yet to find their rhythm. The players are all in the right positions, but none of them willing to bite, to step forward and pressure the man on the ball. They are playing within themselves, showing too much respect to Manchester United. Ronaldo has a shot saved by Victor Valdez. Another shot. United are getting closer. Cristiano fires just wide of the post. Centimetres. That's the difference. Centimetres away from goal. Centimetres away from changing the way the world judges Pep Guardiola and his now-camp revolution. Giggs, Carrick, Anderson are moving the ball around at will between the lines. Something has to be done. Pep leaps from the bench and barks rapid-fire instructions, his voice carrying to his players above the cacophony of noise in a packed Olympic stadium in Rome. Messi is told to take up a position between the United centre-backs as a false striker, and Eto'o is shifted out wide to occupy his place on the right wing. Ferguson, on the bench, impassive, delighted with the outcome so far, feels in control. But the tide changes, imperceptibly at first. Messi finds Iniesta, who finds Xavi, who finds Messi. Suddenly, Carrick and Anderson must react quickly, decide who to mark, which pass to break, space to cover. Giggs is tied up with Busquets and cannot help. Iniesta receives the ball in the centre of the pitch. Evra has lost Eto'o, and Iniesta spots the opportunity opening up on the right flank. He dribbles the ball forward and then, at precisely the right moment, finds Eto'o on the edge of the box with an incisive inch-perfect pass. He receives the ball. Vidic is making a last-ditch attempt to cover him, but Eto'o jinks past him and, in the blink of an eye, relying on his pure assassin's instinct, fires in a shot at the near post. The destination of that shot, that instant, the culmination of a move, would help convert an idea, a seed planted 40 years earlier, into a footballing tsunami that would transform the game for years to come. Prologue. Pep left Barcelona and all he had shaped because, Sir Alex, he is not like most managers. He walked away because he is, quite simply, not your typical football man. You could already see it in your first encounter in the dugout in the Champions League final in Rome in 2009. For that final, Guardiola had made a compendium of his thoughts and applied his club philosophy to everything related to that game, from preparation to tactics, from the last tactical chat to the way they celebrated the victory. Pep had invited the world to join him and his players in the joy of playing a huge European Cup final. He was confident he had prepared the team to beat you, but if that was not possible, the fans would take home the pride of having tried it the Barça way and, in the process, of having overcome a dark period in their history. Not only had he changed a negative trend within the club, but he had also, in only 12 months since his arrival, started to bury some powerful, unwritten, but fashionable commandments that talked about the importance of winning above anything else, the impossibility of reconciling the principle of reaching the highest targets with playing well, producing a spectacle, or the one that considered obsolete the essential values of sportsmanship and respect. Who came up with those rules? Who started the fashion? Since day one of his arrival in the dugout at Barcelona, Pep was willing to go against the tide because that was all he believed in. But that was then. By the end of his tenure, he was no longer the youthful, eager, enthusiastic manager you met that night in Rome or the following year in Neon at the UEFA headquarters for a rare moment of socialising. On the day he announced to the world he was leaving his boyhood club after 4 years in charge of the first team, you could see the toll it had taken. It was discernible in his eyes and in his receding hairline, now flecked with grey. But the eyes, it was especially visible if you looked into his eyes. He was no longer as spirited and impressionable as on that morning in Switzerland, when you offered him some words of wisdom and fatherly advice. Did you know that he still talks about that chat, those 15 minutes with you, as one of the highlights of his career? He was like a star-struck teenager, repeating for days afterwards, "I was with Sir Alex. I spoke to Sir Alex Ferguson." Back then, Everything was new and exciting. Obstacles were challenges rather than insurmountable hurdles. On that sunny morning in September 2010, at UEFA's modern rectangular building on the shores of Lake Geneva, the annual Coaches Conference provided the setting for the first social meeting between yourself and Pep Guardiola since you became coaches. Before that, you scarcely had time to exchange anything more than pleasantries in Rome, and Pep had been looking forward to spending some time in your company, away from the pressures of competition. The conference provided an opportunity for coaches to gossip, discuss trends, whinge, and bond as an elite group of professionals who would spend the rest of the year in a state of perpetual solitude, struggling to manage 20 or so egos, plus their families and agents. Among the guests in Neon was a certain José Mourinho, the colourful new manager of Real Madrid and reigning European champion with Inter Milan, the team that had knocked Pep's Barcelona out in the semi-final the previous season. Mid-morning on the first of 2 days, you arrived at UEFA headquarters in one of a pair of minibuses, the first carrying the Portuguese coach, along with the then Chelsea manager, Carlo Ancelotti, and Roma's Claudio Ranieri. Guardiola travelled in the second bus with you. As soon as you entered the building, Mourinho approached the group that had gathered round you, while Guardiola stepped to one side to take it all in, to photograph the moment, always aware of the significance of these events in his own life story. After all, he was surrounded by some of football's great minds. He was there to listen, to watch, and to learn, as he has always done. Pep spent a while on his own, distanced from the conversations that were taking place. Mourinho spotted him out of the corner of his eye and left the group he was in. He greeted Guardiola and shook his hand effusively. The pair smiled. They started talking animatedly for a few minutes, and the Werder Bremen coach, Thomas Schaff, joined in, occasionally managing to catch his colleague's attention. It was the last time Pep Guardiola and José Mourinho were to speak on such amicable terms. The groups entered the main conference hall for the first of the two sessions that day, where you talked about the tactical trends that were used in the previous Champions League campaign, as well as other topics related to the World Cup in South Africa, which Spain had just won. At the end of the first meeting, everyone posed for a group photograph. Didier Deschamps was sitting between Guardiola and Mourinho in the centre of the front row. On the left, you sat next to Ancelotti. There was laughter and banter, and it was developing into quite an entertaining day. Just before the second session, there was time for coffee, and you and Guardiola found yourselves together in a seating area with a breathtaking view of Lake Geneva, overlooking clear blue water and the exclusive homes visible on the far shore. Pep felt humbled in your presence. In his eyes, you were a giant of the dugout, but that morning you were an affable Scot who smiled easily, as you often do when out of the limelight. You admired the younger manager's humility, despite the fact that Pep had already won 7 titles out of a possible 9 at that point, and had the world of football arguing about whether he was implementing an evolution or a revolution at FC Barcelona. The general consensus at the time was that, at the very least, Pep's youth and positivity were a breath of fresh air. That chat over coffee quickly turned into an improvised lesson between teacher and pupil. Pep enjoys spending time watching and taking in what the legends of football have added to the game. In great detail, he recalls Van Gaal's Ajax, Milan's achievements with Sarri. He could talk to you for ages about both, and he holds winning a European Cup in almost the same esteem as he does his shirt, signed by his idol, Michel Platini. You are also a member of Pep's particular Hall of Fame. As the pupil listened, soaking up every word, his respect for you was transformed into devotion. Not only because of the symbolic content of the chat, your vision of the profession, It wasn't just the insight, it was the stature of the man who was doing the talking. He is in awe of the longevity of your tenure at Manchester United, the resilience and inner strength required to stay in the job for so long. Pep has always thought that the pressures at Barcelona and Manchester must be different. He yearns to understand how one sustains the hunger for success and avoids the loss of appetite that must inevitably follow successive victories. He believes that a team that wins all the time needs to lose to benefit from the lessons that only defeat can bring. Pep wants to discover how you deal with that, Sir Alex, how you clear your mind, how you relate to defeat. You didn't have time to talk about everything, but those issues will be raised next time you cross paths. You can be sure of that. Pep venerates your composure in both victory and defeat, and the way you fight tooth and nail to defend your own brand of football. And you also advised him to keep faithful to who he is, to his beliefs and inner self. Pepe, you said to him, and he was too respectful to correct you about getting his name wrong, you have to make sure you don't lose sight of who you are. Many young coaches change for whatever reason, because of circumstances beyond their control, because things don't come out right at first, or because success can change you. All of a sudden, they want to amend tactics themselves. They don't realise football is a monster that you can only beat and face if you are always yourself, under any circumstance. For you, it was perhaps little more than some friendly advice. Satisfying a fatherly instinct you have often had for the new faces on the scene. Yet, unintentionally perhaps, you revealed to Pep the secrets of your enduring resilience in the football profession. Your need to continue, and your strange relationship with the sport, where sometimes you feel trapped, and at other times liberated. Your words came back to him more than once, while he was agonizingly deliberating his future. He understands what you were talking about, but nevertheless, he could not help changing during his 4 years leading the Barcelona first team. Football, that monster, transformed him. You warned him against losing sight of his true self, but he changed partly due to the pressure from a grateful and adoring fan base, who forgot he was only a football coach, partly because of his own behaviour. Eventually, being unable to take decisions that would hurt him and hurt his players. The emotional toll ended up being too much, became insurmountable, in fact. He reached a point where Pep believed the only way he could recover some of his true self was to leave behind everything that he had helped create. It turned out that as much as he wanted to heed your advice, Pep is not like you, Sir Alex. You sometimes compare football to a strange type of prison, one that you in particular don't want to escape. Arsene Wenger shares your view and is also incapable of empathising with or understanding Guardiola's decision to abandon a gloriously successful team with the world's best player at his disposal, adored and admired by all. On the morning that Pep announced his departure from Barcelona, 3 days after Chelsea had shocked the football world by dumping them out of the Champions League in the semi-final, Wenger told the media, "The philosophy of Barcelona has to be bigger than winning or losing a championship. After being knocked out of the Champions League, it may not be the right moment to make this decision." I would have loved to see Guardiola, even going through a disappointing year, stay and come back and insist with his philosophy. That would be interesting. Guardiola's mind is often in turmoil, spinning at 100 RPM before every decision, still questioning it even after he's come to a conclusion. He couldn't escape his destiny as a coach going back to Barcelona, but he is incapable of living with the level of intensity that would eventually grind him down. His world is full of uncertainty, debate, doubts and demands that he can never reconcile or satisfy. They are ever present, when he is golfing with his friends or sprawled on the sofa at home watching a movie with his partner Chris and their three children, or unable to sleep at night. Wherever he is always working, thinking, deciding, always questioning, and the only way he can disconnect from his job and the huge expectations is to sever his ties completely. He arrived full of life as a novice coach with the B team in 2007. He left as first team coach, drained, 5 years and 14 titles later. Don't take my word for it. Pep himself said how exhausted he felt in the press conference when he confirmed that he was leaving. Remember when, before the 2011 Ballon d'Or event, you were once asked about Pep? You were both at the press conference that coincided with your Lifetime Achievement Award and Pep's recognition as Manager of the Year. You were frank in your response. Where is Guardiola going to go that will be better than at home? I don't understand why he would want to leave all that. That same day, Andoni Zubizarreta, the Barcelona director of football and longtime friend of Pep, aware of the influence of that chat in Neil and the esteem he holds you in, referred to your words in conversation with Guardiola. Look what this wise man, Alex Ferguson, full of real world and football experience, is saying, to which Pep, having already told Zubi that he was thinking of leaving at the end of that season, replied, "You bastard. You're always looking for ways to confuse me." Sir Alex, just look at the images of Pep when he first stepped up to take charge of Barcelona's first team in 2008. He was a youthful-looking 37-year-old, eager, ambitious, energetic. Now look at him, 4 years later. He doesn't look 41, does he? On that morning in Neon, he was a coach in the process of elevating a club to new, dizzying heights, of helping a team make history. By the time of your brief chat overlooking Lake Geneva, Pep had already found innovative, tactical solutions, but in the following seasons he was going to defend and attack in even more revolutionary ways, and his team was going to win almost every competition in which they took part. The problem was that, along the way, every victory was one victory closer to, not further from, the end. A nation starved of contemporary role models, struggling through a recession, elevated Pep into a social leader, the perfect man, an ideal. Scary even for Pep. As you know, Sir Alex, nobody is perfect, and you might disagree, but there are very, very few who can endure the weight of such a burden upon their shoulders. To be a coach at Barcelona requires a lot of energy, and after 4 years, now that he no longer enjoyed the European nights, now that Real Madrid had made La Liga an exhausting challenge, both on and off the pitch, Pep felt it was time to depart from the all-consuming entity he had served, with a break of only 6 years, since he was 13. And when he returns, because he will return, isn't it best to do so having left on a high? Look again at the pictures of Pep, Sir Alex. Does it not now become clearer that he has given his all for FC Barcelona? Part 1. Why did he have to leave? Chapter 1. The Whys. In November 2011, just before the last training session ahead of the trip to Milan for a Champions League group game, Pep, who was in his fourth year with the first team, asked the players to form a circle. He started to explain the secret that he, Tito Villanova, and the doctors had kept from the squad, but he couldn't articulate what he wanted to say. The enormity of the moment left him lost for words. He was anxious and uncomfortable. His voice wobbled and he moved aside. The doctors took over and explained the gravity of the situation to the players, while Pep kept looking at the floor and drinking from his ever-present bottle of water that was supposed to prevent his voice from quavering. It didn't work on that occasion. The medical staff explained that the assistant manager, Tito Villanova, Pep's right-hand man and close friend, would have to undergo emergency surgery to remove a tumour from his parotid gland, the largest of the salivary glands, and therefore he would not be able to travel to Italy with them. 2 hours later, the Barcelona players left town in a state of shock. Pep appeared distant, isolated, wandering separately from the group, deep in contemplation. The team ended up beating Milan 3-2 at the San Siro to top the Champions League group in a thrilling game in which neither side concentrated on defending, treating the fans to an end-to-end encounter with lots of chances. But despite the result, Pep remained understandably melancholic. Life, as the saying goes, is what happens when you are busy making other plans. It is also that thing that slaps you in the face and makes you fall when you think you are invincible. When you forget, falling is also part of the rules. Guardiola, who accelerated his inquisition of everything when he found out his friend was ill, went through a similar thought process when he was told that Eric Abidal had a tumour on his liver the previous season. The French left-back recovered enough to play a brief part in the second leg of the semi-finals of the Champions League against Real Madrid, in what Pep would describe as the most emotional night he could remember at the Camp Nou. Abidal came on in the 90th minute when the game was 1-1 and Barcelona were on the verge of another Champions League final, having beaten Madrid in the first leg. The stadium gave him a powerful standing ovation, which was something of a rarity. For Catalans are very much like the English. They have a safety in numbers approach to showing their feelings, until a collective wave of public emotion lets them release much of what they innately repress. Weeks later, Puyol, unbeknown to Pep or anybody in the squad, would give Abidal the captain's armband to allow him to receive the European Cup from Platini. Almost a year later, the doctors would tell the French left-back that the treatment had failed and he needed a transplant. The health problems of Abidal and Villanova left Guardiola shaken. They hit him very hard. It was an unforeseen, uncontrollable situation. Difficult to deal with for someone who likes to predict and micromanage what happens in the squad, and to have a contingency plan when things come out of the blue. But with them, he was helpless. There was nothing he could do. Much more than that, the lives of people he felt responsible for were on the line. After that victory in Milan, Barcelona had to travel to Madrid to play a modest Getafe side. Defeat meant that neither Guardiola nor the team who dominated that game but failed to make an impact in front of their opponent's goal could dedicate a victory that night to Tito Villanova, who was on the road to recovery following a successful operation to remove the tumour. Barcelona lost the game 1-0 in a cold, half-empty stadium in the kind of ugly match in which it was becoming increasingly more challenging to inspire a group of players and also the manager, who had been the protagonists on so many glorious nights. Pep was upset at dropping 3 points, as their league campaign seemed to be faltering far too early in the season. Real Madrid, who had beaten their city rival Atletico de Madrid 4-1 away, were now 5 points ahead, and they seemed unstoppable, hungry for success, and with a burning desire to bring Guardiola's era to an end. La Liga wasn't the only reason for Pep feeling low, and his appearance after the game worried members of the team. On the flight back to Barcelona, in the early hours of Sunday, the 27th of November, 2011, Pep had never looked more isolated, down in the dumps and untalkative. Far more bitter than he would have been had it just been a case of dealing with a defeat. There was a space next to him on the plane, an empty aisle seat, and nobody wanted to fill it. It was where Tito Villanova would have sat. It would be difficult to pinpoint a lower moment for the Barca coach's morale. It would be silly not to see the job through. That is what Sir Alex Ferguson would have told Pep before he made his decision. But the Manchester United manager might have thought differently had he seen Pep alone on that flight. and Doni Zubizarreta had witnessed firsthand the effect of Tito's illness on Pep. He'd seen it on the trips to Milan and Madrid, and in the way the coach behaved at the training ground around those games. It was as if he'd had a puncture and all his energy was leaking out through the hole. He seemed deflated, thinner, stooped, suddenly older and greyer. Zubi wished now he'd known then what to say to Pep, how to comfort and support him. It might not have changed anything, but the feeling of regret persists. Of course, Tito pulled through, but that week confirmed Pep's worst fears. He was not ready for more, more responsibility, more searching for solutions, more crisis avoidance, and endless hours of work and preparation, more time away from his family. It confirmed a nagging doubt that had persisted since October, when just after the Barty-Borisov Champions League game, he told Zubi and President Sandro Rosell that he didn't feel strong enough to continue for another season. That if he was asked to renew his contract right then, his answer would be no. It was not a formal decision, but he was making his feelings known. The reaction of the club was instant. He would be given time. There was no need to rush. Zubi, a lifelong friend and colleague, understands Pep's character and knew that it was best not to put pressure on him. The director of football hoped that Pep's revelation could be attributed to him feeling a little tired, understandably low, something of an emotional roller coaster that he had seen Guardiola riding on a few occasions when they were teammates. Yet Zubizarreta also recalled a meal he had with Pep in his first season with the first team. It was a meeting between friends. Zubi wasn't working for the club at that point, and Pep was still very excited about what he was doing with the side and how well everything was being received. His enthusiasm was contagious. Yet he reminded Zubizarreta that his job at Barcelona came with an expiry date. It was a defence mechanism for Pep, because he knew as well as anybody that the club could chew up and spit out managers mercilessly. Pep was insistent that one day he would lose his players. His messages wouldn't carry the same weight, that the whole environment, the media, the president's enemies, talk show panels, former coaches and players, would be impossible to control in the long term. A friend of Pep's, Charlie Reshak, former player, assistant manager to Johan Cruyff and Barcelona first-team coach, an icon of the Catalan club and legendary public philosopher, always said that a Barcelona manager dedicates only 30% of his efforts to the team. The other 70% is spent dealing with the rest of the baggage that comes with such a huge institution. Pep sensed this when he was a player, but as a coach he quickly experienced that interminable pressure and that Charlie's calculation was correct. Johan Cruyff, who regularly shared long meals with Guardiola, understood that as well and had already warned Pep that the second year was harder than the first and the third harder than the second. And if he could relive his experience as boss of the Dream Team, he would have left the club 2 years earlier. "Don't stay longer than you should," Cruyff told Pep on one occasion. So Zubizarreta knew it was going to be difficult to convince him to stay, but would give it his best shot. The director of football mixed protection with silence and sometimes a bit of pressure in search of an answer. The answer never came. Guardiola's responses to Zubi's questions about his future were always the same. "You already know what I'm going through. It is difficult." And, "We'll talk, we'll talk." At the start of the 2011-12 season, after the league and the Champions League had been won, Guardiola called a meeting with his players to remind them what every coach has told his successful team since the day football was invented. "You should know that the story doesn't end here. You must keep on winning." And the team continued winning silverware, the Spanish Super Cup, the European Super Cup, and the World Club Championship in December. With limited weapons in his armoury, due to the absences of Villa and Abidal, and after having built a small squad, Barcelona paid a high price in La Liga for the energy they put into the Copa and the Super Cup, games in which they celebrated wins over Real Madrid. Barcelona's fan base supported Pep, obsessed as they all were with halting their bitter rivals' revival. In September, the game against AC Milan in the group stage of the Champions League was a turning point and an omen for the season ahead. The Italians drew 2-2 in the last minutes of the game at the Camp Nou. The equaliser, the consequence of a poorly defended corner, and Guardiola reached the conclusion that his team had lost its competitive edge and there was a lack of attention being paid to the finer points that had made Barcelona so special. This was followed by a run of relatively poor away form in La Liga that included that 1-0 defeat to Getafe in November. Pep periodically asked himself if the players were getting his message the way they were a few years ago. He debated the reasons why the 3-4-3 system he had been using that year wasn't working to plan. He took risks with the lineup, as if he knew that there wouldn't be a fifth season. He sensed that it was getting increasingly difficult to control his players, some of whom could even lose their way in the world of football if they didn't start correcting their bad habits. Dani Alves, who separated from his wife during the summer and made the mistake of returning late from his holidays over Christmas, was given the unexpected surprise of a week off mid-season to clear his mind, an unprecedented move, at least one done so openly in the history of Spanish football's greats. Furthermore, there were a couple of occasions when the fullback would receive a telling off in front of his teammates for not paying attention to tactics, something Pep rarely did. "A defender, first and foremost, you're a defender," he told him after a game, in which he got involved in the attack more than he should have done. The Brazilian, meanwhile, was unimpressed when he was left on the bench. He wasn't the only one. Seeing their distraught faces during games upset Pep. He spoke indirectly to the players who were angry about being left out of the team by praising the behaviour of players such as Puyol and Keita when they weren't starting. "I'm sure they've called me everything, but the first thing they did when they found out was support the team," he told them. Logically, those kinds of problems multiplied as the seasons went by, commonplace in any dressing room. But every conflict, even the most trivial, was chipping away at the bridges Pep had so delicately constructed with his squad. There were still high points. Barcelona eliminated Real Madrid in the quarterfinals of the Cup in February, and Guardiola appeared to have gone back to being the Pep of previous seasons, energetic, challenging, inexhaustible. The team was still fighting for every trophy, and the board thought that success would convince him to stay, even though his silence on his future had started to become the subject of criticism from some directors, who referred to Pep as the Dalai Lama or the mystic. In a way, the club was a hostage to Guardiola's decision. Little by little, Zubizarreta was trying to find common ground to get Pep to put pen to paper on a new contract. Then, in November, the director of football proposed Tito Villanova as Pep's successor, an almost logical plan B, perhaps, but also a tactic to get Pep to visualise his departure and, perhaps, make him think twice about it. Secretly, the club calculated that Pep's birthday could be the turning point. 2 years before, on his 39th birthday, Pep went with his girlfriend Chris to see the Catalan band Manel. His lack of renewal had become national news, and the band and the audience changed the words of a song to wish him a happy birthday and demand his signature. The next day, Pep announced he was staying for another year. By the 18th of January 2012, on his 41st anniversary, Tito Villanova had returned to the team. Barcelona had destroyed Santos in the FIFA Club World Cup final in Tokyo, and the club thought the conditions were right for Pep to change his mind. But the confirmation wasn't forthcoming. Over the course of the following months, up until the 25th of April 2012, when he announced that his decision was final, both the director of football and the president, Sandro Rosell, would subtly introduce the conversation even in private dinners. "So how are things going?" Sandro asked him at an event in February, surrounded by figures from Catalan politics and society. Perhaps not the best moment to raise the issue. "Now's not the time, President," was Pep's blunt response. He never let his guard down. Rossell had won the presidential elections in 2010, after Joan Laporta ended his final permitted term. Months before, Pep had agreed to stay on for a season, but wanted the new man in charge to confirm the details. 2 weeks after Rossell was voted in, the contract had not been signed, agreed, negotiated, or even talked about. In the meantime, Dmytro Chigrinsky, signed the previous season for €25 million, was sold for €15 million back to Shakhtar Donetsk, from where he had originally come. Guardiola was not pleased. He didn't want his centre-back to go, but the club, he was told, needed to pay wages, having run out of cash, thus shrewdly proving the point that Laporta had left the club in a poor financial state. The response came quickly. Johan Cruyff, Pep's mentor, returned the medal given to him by Laporta as a president of honour, a very public gesture that amounted to an official declaration of war between the two presidents, a throwing down of the gauntlet, and Guardiola was going to be placed in the middle of it all. It was clearly not the beginning of a mutual friendship. Life in the director's box had been infernal since Rossell's arrival. False accusations of doping against Barcelona made on national radio, the Champions League semi-finals against Real Madrid and its implications, the future of the manager. But the new president preferred to keep a low profile, in contrast to the loquacious Laporta, partly because he felt out of place. Rossell sensed his hands were tied by a club that had elevated to an idol, whether or not he wanted it, the figure of Guardiola. So he had to follow the coach's line in many issues he would have argued against if he had had more authority. The vast number of assistants, the resultant cost, and above all, the signing of Cesc Fabregas. When Rossell, who was reluctant to end the feud with his nemesis, brought a civil lawsuit against Laporta for alleged financial maladministration of the club, which could have meant the freezing of Laporta's properties and assets, Pep met the former president for dinner. He watched as his friend, the man who had given him his first coaching job, cried openly. He was about to lose everything, and his personal life was falling apart. A few days later, Guardiola admitted in a press conference that he felt sorry for Laporta. That was, according to Rossell's acolytes, an unpleasant surprise. The situation was diffused and the civil lawsuit abandoned, but nothing gets forgotten in the camp now. So it is no wonder Guardiola never had the same level of mutual devotion with Rossell as he had with Laporta. But a president doesn't have to love you. When Rossell was asked in London, after the club had been awarded the Laureus as the World Team of the Year, what would happen if Pep left at the end of the season, the president answered, "There was life at the club before him and will be after him." No, he doesn't have to love you, but it would have been beneficial for the club if it hadn't been so obvious that the two men were on completely different wavelengths. Make a list of the things that you would like to do next season. It will help you to reflect and see if what you write down is exactly what you want to do. Zubizarreta kept trying. He had thought of a good way to make Guardiola reflect on the decision that seemed to be taking form in his mind. Pep laughed. "It's not the time," he repeated. The very light pressure was not working, so it was almost better not even to mention it. Zubi's tactics changed again, and the topic hardly ever came up in conversation between the president, the sporting director, and the coach from that moment on. It would be up to the manager, whenever he was ready, to tell them what he wanted to do. There were occasions during the season when Pep would look through a talkative Zubizarreta, a half-smile on his lips perhaps, and his friend would know that the coach was miles away, and that it was the wrong time to talk about that or really anything significant, that there was no way at that point to communicate with Pep. His players will tell you that, like Zubizarreta himself, they feel they know him pretty well. They recognise the guy who jokes with them, the one who has a presence that makes them sit up and pay attention. A coach whose care for the smallest detail improves them, who can see and communicate the secrets of a game. But they would also say that there is a lot they cannot understand about their boss. They see a complex man with so much on his mind, always mulling things over, excessively so sometimes. Players say they are sure he would love to spend more time with his wife and kids, but he can't, because he dedicates the vast majority of his time to winning games. He lives for that, but sometimes even they wonder, does he overdo it? For Pep, that excessiveness is exactly what he needs to find that flash of inspiration. That moment when he realises what the next game will be like, or discovers how it can be won. That moment that gives sense to his profession, as he puts it. Despite having 24 assistants, he worked longer hours than most of them, and although the club offered him a unit of experts who could analyse games, he could never bring himself to surrender control of that part of the job. For me, the most wonderful thing is planning what is going to happen in each game, Guardiola has explained. Which players I have at my disposal, which tools I can use, what the opposition is like. I want to imagine what will happen. I always try and give the players the security of knowing what they'll encounter. This increases the possibility of doing things well. Moving from task to task, from deadline to deadline, is when he feels most alive, totally immersed or dashing between several projects, addicted to the adrenaline rush generated by it. And that way of understanding his profession fulfills and yet consumes him. But it is the only one possible for him, and the one pledged to the fans. I promise you that we'll work hard. I don't know if we'll win, but we will try very hard. Fasten your seatbelts. You're going to enjoy the ride. It's what he told them at the presentation of the team in summer of 2008. That work ethic, instilled in him by his parents, is very much part of the Catalan character. Saving the soul through industry, effort, honest labour, and giving your all to the job. In a suitably symbolic place, the Catalan Parliament, and on being awarded the nation's gold medal, the country's highest accolade for a Catalan citizen, in recognition for his representation of Catalan sporting values, he said in his acceptance speech, "If we get up early, very early, and think about it, believe me, we are an unstoppable country." But at the same time, Pep sets impossibly high standards and is beset by a sense of never being quite good enough. Guardiola might look strong and capable of carrying a club and a nation on his shoulders, but he is very sensitive about the reaction of the team and about disappointing the fans by not meeting their expectations, or his own. He once confided to a close friend, "I can imagine the most amazing solution to a problem, and then sometimes players come out with something better during the game that I hadn't thought of. Then that, for me, is like a little defeat. It means I should have found that solution earlier." The club, the director of football and the coach try to reduce the element of surprise, of unpredictability in a game through training and analysing the opposition. Before a game, the manager wants to know which approach to take. But in the end, it comes down to the player. It can't be directed. And what's more, there are infinite variables on the pitch. How else can Iniesta's goal at Stamford Bridge in 2009 be explained, when Barcelona seem to have lost the game? For Pep, that is the wonder of football. And the frustration, too, trying to make something so unpredictable predictable. No matter how hard he works, he is fighting a losing battle. Guardiola loves football, his friend, the film director David Trueba, wrote, and he loves winning, because that is what the game is about. But particularly by doing justice to the approach. He proposes a system, and he only asks for you to trust him, that you are faithful to him. The day he notices players who are uncommitted, apathetic, doubtful, even after an irrelevant training session, he is a sad man, demoralized, willing to leave everything. No one should be confused about this, Trueba continues. He is an obsessive professional who pays attention to detail, knowing that details can decide a game. He reveres the club he works for and has imposed a rule not to be more than a mere piece in the structure, to earn his salary and never ask for as much as a coffee without paying for it. He doesn't aspire to be recognised as an indoctrinator, a guru or a guide. He just wants to be recognised as a coach, a good coach. The other things, the good and the bad, are burdens put on him by a society in need of role models. Perhaps everybody is tired of cheats, of profiteers, of villains, people who impose selfish values, opportunism and selfishness from the privileged platform of television or the media, business or politics. He belongs to that society, but he dignifies it in a very simple way, trying to do his job well, helping to make common sense prosper from his place in the public eye, with the same quiet dignity with which a good bricklayer, without anyone looking or applauding, lays bricks. A manager's work is never done, Pep was often heard saying. But one morning, following one of those evenings in which Pep, a football freak, enfermo de football, as he has lovingly been called by some of his star players, stayed at the training ground watching videos that had already been dissected and analysed by his colleagues. The coaching staff saw him walk across the training ground, looking under the weather. The enthusiastic Pep they had seen the previous day had made way for a silent Pep, whose words said one thing and his sunken eyes another. "What's wrong?" one of his colleagues asked him. "Yesterday I should have gone to see my daughter in a ballet and I couldn't go." "Why not?" his friend asked, surprised. "Because I was watching videos of our opponent." "Look, every day I think that I'm leaving tomorrow," Guardiola said publicly 2 years into the job. "When you're in charge of something, you always have to bear in mind that you can leave. I work better thinking that I am free to decide my own future. Being tied to a contract for a long time distresses me, and this can make you lose your passion. That is why I sign year by year. If I could, I would sign only for 6 months. I have always thought that everything starts from looking for what you really like, which nowadays is the hardest thing to find. Finding that is the essence of everything." But that essence in his last season was eluding him. He was not even enjoying the big European nights, tormented by his worries and indecision. Should I continue? Is it better for Barcelona for me to carry on? Or should I look for new messages, new solutions to keep people on their toes? How can I find new ways to give Leo Messi what he needs? And Iniesta, and Cesc, and Alves? Can I carry on with this for another month, another year? How do young coaches grow old, having been successful so early? Wouldn't it be better to find new horizons? Roman Abramovich had been aware of Guardiola's anxieties for a few years, and he wanted to take advantage of the situation. He pursued Pep persistently for 2 years before he left Barcelona and tried to convince him on many occasions to take the reins at Stamford Bridge. After Ancelotti's departure from Chelsea in the summer of 2011, the owner's pursuit gained momentum. André Villas-Boas was the fourth choice candidate to replace the Italian, behind Gus Hiddink, José Mourinho and Pep, who in February of that year had renewed his contract for another season. In June, just before the start of Guardiola's last season in charge of Barca, Abramovich, working through a middleman, invited Pep to be picked up by private helicopter and whisked away to a meeting on his yacht in Monaco. "Stop telling me these things. I don't want to meet Roman, or I might have my head turned by him," was Pep's polite answer. But Abramovich was going to come back during his final months in charge of Barcelona. On two occasions, he offered Rafa Benitez a three-month deal to finish the season after the sacking of André Villas-Boas. The Chelsea owner thought he could convince Pep to forget his sabbatical and take over at Stamford Bridge straight after leaving Barcelona. The Chelsea owner's last offer before Pep Guardiola disappeared from the public eye at the end of the 2012 season proposed the appointment of an interim manager for one season to leave the Stamford Bridge door open for Pep a year later, wanting him to design the squad for the 2013-14 season as soon as he was ready. Chelsea had become the first club to actively try and seduce him. AC Milan, Inter and Bayern Munich would follow. There was a moment earlier on in the season that was to have an impact upon the squad dynamic for the remainder of the campaign. In the third league game, Pep left Messi on the bench for the game against Real Sociedad in San Sebastian. He thought the player would be tired after returning from duties with the Argentine national team. Leo was spectacularly angry, so much so that his contribution during the few minutes he did play was almost non-existent, and he didn't turn up for training the next day. From that day onwards, Messi did not miss a game. Messi's role was something to think about. Pep had created a team that revolved around the diminutive, record-breaking Argentinian, and there was an abundance of forwards who had come and gone. Ibrahimovic, Eto, Bojan, even David Villa had to get used to playing in the wing, although upon his arrival, he had been told that he would be Barca's number nine, having been unable to fit in a style of play that demanded submission to Messi. When the team began to falter, especially in away games, the Argentinian was given more responsibility, and Pep selected sides to support him. But that prioritising of Messi reduced others' responsibilities and terrified the younger players. Messi ended up netting 73 goals that 2011-12 season in all competitions. In contrast, the next highest goalscorers were Cesc and Alexis with 15 each. Pep was creating a goalscoring monster, but collectively the team was suffering for it, and he knew he was as responsible for this situation as any of his players. As Johan Cruyff said, Guardiola has had to control a lot of egos in the dressing room. It's not surprising that he has run out of energy. Pep Guardiola rang one of the World Games' leading managers to ask him one question. If you get to a situation where the balance seems broken, what do you do? Do you go or do you change players? He was given the answer that he perhaps didn't want to hear. You change players. That is what Sir Alex Ferguson has always done. But clearly the United manager feels less beholden to his footballers, both morally and emotionally, than Pep, who invested an awful lot of personal feeling into his first experience as a manager. Too much, in fact. Guardiola needed pills to help him sleep and would go for walks with his partner and their children to help him to find some sort of emotional balance. At one point, the team trailed 13 points behind Madrid. What I have done so far doesn't guarantee me anything. If the fans have their doubts, they will have their own reasons for that, he said, in one of the most delicately poised moments of the season. The statistics were still impressive, but less so than in the previous three seasons. The team was losing its competitive edge, and Pep felt it was his fault. After the defeat to Osasuna in Pamplona, 3-2 in February, he said, "We've made too many mistakes. I didn't know how to answer the questions before they were asked. I failed. I didn't do my job well enough." But in fact, Pep had one trick left up his sleeve. He followed Johan Cruyff's example by employing reverse psychology and admitting publicly that Barcelona were not going to win this league. It had the desired effect. Players, suspicious that the manager was thinking of leaving them, wanted to show that they were still up for the challenge, still hungry. Barcelona clawed back some ground on Madrid, getting to within 4 points of their rivals. But it was too little, too late. Defeat to their bitter rivals at the Camp Nou in May effectively handed the title to Mourinho and the old enemy. There were uncharacteristic complaints about the referee from Pep in various press conferences during the last few months of the season, a search for excuses that revealed how Guardiola was perhaps losing his focus. Pep struggled to accept a fact of life, that after a period of unprecedented success, 13 titles in his first 3 years with the first team, there must inevitably be a slump. If you win all the time, there's less desire to carry on winning. He tried to prevent this inevitable cycle by putting in longer shifts and making huge sacrifices. Even taking care of himself dropped down his list of priorities, and health problems were ignored until they became debilitating, such as the slipped disc that incapacitated him for a few days in March. The coaching staff's analysis was that mistakes weren't being made during the team talks. They were still based on in-depth studies of their rivals and delivered with the same enthusiasm and charisma as ever, but rather in their execution. But there were question marks over Pep's faith in first-team newcomers from La Masia. Tello, who started on the wing against Real Madrid at the Camp Nou in what was a key victory for Mourinho's team, and Cuenca in the 11 against Chelsea in the return leg of the semi-finals of the 2012 Champions League, were expected to produce the same level of performance as Cesc, Alexis or Pedro, who were left out in one of the two games. Could Barcelona afford to leave that sort of talent on the bench? Was Pep too close to the squad to actually see the wood for the trees? These were pivotal decisions that affected the outcome of the season. And Guardiola's judgment in replacing experienced internationals with near debutants in season-defining games raised more than a few eyebrows. It also had a negative impact on the confidence of the youngsters selected and the older players dropped. Jose Mourinho watched it all from Madrid with a wry smile. The impact of Mourinho and his destabilizing strategies is irrefutable, even though Pep would always deny it. When asked what he remembered of the previous Clásicos on the eve of his last as coach, Pep lowered his voice. "I don't have fond memories of either the victories or the defeats. There are always reasons that aren't related to the game that have made a lot of things incomprehensible to me." Really? He couldn't remember even the 2-6 demolition at the Bernabeu, the 5-0 in Mourinho's first Clásico, described by many as the best performance in the history of the game. There was enormous pressure, not just from Mourinho, but from Madrid's sporting press, who went as far as insulting Pep and suggesting Barcelona's performances were enhanced by drugs. For a sensitive soul like Pep, it was enough to wipe out even the best memories. As the season was reaching the end, the decision about his future became unmovable. He was going to leave the club that was one of the most admired on the planet, courtesy of his leadership. He just had to find the right way to tell the club, and the players, and the fans. But how? If they won the Champions League, everything would be much easier. While he finalised the details of his departure, he decided not to share his decision with anyone, not even his parents. Chapter 2. The Decision. Before he made an official announcement, the biggest hint that Guardiola gave about his future was inadvertently revealed in a chat with an Italian journalist in his third year with the first team. In an interview that was to feature in a DVD on the history of Brescia. But Pep, who normally doesn't do on-the-record one-to-one interviews, but making an exception here, was betrayed and his quotes were leaked to Italian national television. It wasn't so much an evaluation of his personal situation, but the description of an historic constant applicable not just to Barcelona, but to the majority of great clubs. "In order to be in a great institution for 4 years," Guardiola said, "you must have a lot of courage. The players get tired of you, and you get tired of the players. The press gets tired of you, and you get tired of the press, seeing the same faces, the same questions, the same things. In the end, you must know when the time comes, in the same way that I understood that when I was a player, and said, 'Look, it's time for me to leave.'" It turns out that Pep now felt the time had come for him to leave as a manager too. Just after Chelsea qualified for the Champions League final, after drawing 2-2 winning 3-2 on aggregate, in Barcelona, playing with 10 men for almost an hour, Guardiola met the president, Sandro Rosell, at the Camp Nou. "Come and see me at my house tomorrow morning, president," the coach said. Pep also talked to his assistant, Tito Villanova, telling him that, as Villanova already suspected, he was not going to continue. Guardiola also surprised him with a prediction. "I think they're going to propose that you take over," he said, "and I will back you up with whatever decision you take." Unbeknown to Villanova, his name had first been proposed in a conversation between Zubizarreta and Guardiola the previous November. "Do you think Tito can replace you if you decide to leave?" the director of football asked. "For sure," was Pep's answer, even though he had no idea if his friend was going to take the job, or if Zubizarreta was being serious. At 9 a.m. the following day, Pep Guardiola held a meeting at his house with Sandro Rosell, Andoni Zubizarreta, Tito Villanova, and Vice President Giuseppe Maria Bertomeu. It was then that he broke the news to the club hierarchy that he would not continue at FC Barcelona. The meeting lasted for 3 hours, as Pep explained his reasons for calling it a day. "You know all those things we have been talking about during the season? Nothing has changed. I am leaving. I have to leave," Pep told them. The defeat to Real Madrid and the loss against Chelsea weren't the cause, but both had served as a catalyst for the chain of events. The following day he told his parents, and although his mother, Dolores, believed that her son's health comes first, she also felt that her heart shrank on hearing the news. He needed, according to Dolores, a place of rest and relaxation. That is also how his father, Valenti, saw it. His son felt overwhelmed by so much responsibility towards the members, the fans, and the club. His dad, according to Ramon Besa in El País, understood and even predicted the outcome, having said back in September, when Guardiola received the gold medal from the Catalan Parliament, that as soon as the tributes start pouring in, it's time to start packing your bags. As journalist Louis Martin, also from El País, discovered, many tried to change Pep's mind in the 2 days leading up to the formal public announcement. SMS messages from Valdez, Iniesta, Xavi, and especially Messi flooded his inbox. Even Villanova asked him to reconsider. Zubizarreta ended up having a crazy idea, one of those forlorn hopes that you have to express even when you already know the answer. "There's a vacancy in one of the youth teams. Why don't you take it? What you like most of all is training the kids, isn't it?" Pep looked at him, trying to work out what was behind the question. He answered him with the same sense of ambiguity. "God, that could be a good idea." The two friends laughed. 2 days after announcing his departure to the president, it was time to tell the players. Nobody in the squad was sure of the outcome. Following the Champions League semi-final defeat to Chelsea, Carles Puyol waiting around after the match to give a urine sample for a routine drugs test, saw that Pep was stalling his arrival at the press conference. He thought it was a positive sign, so he told a teammate, "He will tell us this week he is staying. You will see, he doesn't want to leave us now." Puyol, as he now admits, doesn't have a future as a clairvoyant. After the Champions League game, the players were given 2 days off. They had heard the rumours and knew about the meeting with Rosell, but were unsure about what was going to happen. The morning papers came with headlines which confirmed that nobody outside the club had a clear idea of what was about to take place. The front page of Mundo Deportivo split its front page in two, one half with a headline, "Pep to leave," and the other with, "Pep to stay." The majority of players thought that the meeting before training was merely to receive confirmation that Guardiola was staying. "He seems all right," they said to each other. They were hoping he had managed to shake off his fears and doubts and stay a bit longer, even one more season. Only a handful of people knew for sure what was going to be said. The players gathered in the dressing room at the training ground. There were no jokes, just a low murmur of conversation which turned to silence once Pep walked in and started speaking. As the players were being told, Sky Sports News reported his decision. What he revealed was a shock. The Barcelona manager was departing. "You're the best, and I'm proud of you all. But now I have not got the energy to continue, and it is time to leave. I'm drained." He appeared relaxed, but his voice betrayed his emotions. He was using the same tricks that were so common to him when he wanted to show them where the weakness of the rival team was. He was trying to convince them it was the best that could happen, and to do so, he dwelt on his players' feelings. "Around October, I told the president that the end of my time as manager was close. But I couldn't tell you then, because it would have been problematic. Now it is definite. The next manager to come in will give things that I can no longer give. He will be strong. It would have been a risk for me to continue, because we would have hurt each other. I think a lot of you all, and I would never forgive myself. There have been many moves that I have imagined that you have made a reality. So I leave with a feeling of having done the job well, of having fulfilled my duty. This club has an unstoppable power, but I am the third coach in its history with the most number of games played in just 4 years. What we have done has been exceptional, because Barcelona coaches don't last long. And we have lasted this long because we have won. But while that was happening, my strength was disappearing. I am leaving as a very happy man. The president has offered me another position, but I need to be away from it all if I want to recharge again." There was further silence after those words were spoken, so he continued, "I wanted to tell you, now that we are out of the big competitions, so I have time to say goodbye to everyone and call you individually into the office to thank you personally. I don't want applause or anything, so let's get to training." And Pep clapped his hands together to emphasise that the talk was over. It was an order to get up and move on. In less than a quarter of an hour, the history of the club had received a definitive twist. Players were confused, bewildered. Pep asked very little of his footballers that day on the training ground. He knew that he had dealt them a bitter blow. For the players running out onto the pitch, that session represented the first steps on the road to healing. For Pep, it represented the beginning of the end of a journey that had begun around 3 decades earlier in a sleepy little Catalan village called Sant Pedor. Part 2. From a Sant Pedor square to the Camp Nou dugout. Main square of the village of Sant Pedor, almost any given morning in 1979. As you approach Pep's childhood home in Sant Pedor, there is a striking view across the immense valley in which the village is situated. The air is fresh, but it carries the smell of the dry earth. Looming on the horizon, the rocky outline of Montserrat, Catalonia's striking, iconic, serrated mountain, soars up out of the valley like a giant cardboard cutout, providing a majestic backdrop for the sleepy Catalan village, situated 70 kilometres from Barcelona. One of the first buildings you come across on the outskirts of this village of only 7,500 inhabitants is the new home of Guardiola's parents, built by Pep's father, a bricklayer, a modern three-storey edifice just off the main road in an area dotted with new-build properties. As you head towards the centre of Sant Pedor, a few dilapidated factories remind you of the village's more recent industrial past and provide a stark contrast to the medieval archways. Sant Pedor is the kind of village where people greet one another in the streets, whether they know each other or not. And those who do know each other stop for a chat about the same topics as any other day. The broad roads start to merge into narrow labyrinths, centuries-old streets winding their way towards Sant Pedor's two main squares, the Plaza Gran and the Plaza de la Generalitat. The latter also used to be known as the Plaza de Berga, but now it is more commonly referred to as the square where Guardiola was born. On any given morning in 1979, a skinny 8-year-old boy would come out of number 15, Plaza de la Generalitat, and walk the few steps towards the centre of the square with a football under his arm. Known to the locals as Guardi, the kid, with spindly legs like twigs, would call out for his friends, including a girl named Pilar, to join him. He would kick the ball against the wall until enough of his mates had arrived for a kickabout. PlayStations didn't exist back then, and there were hardly enough cars on the roads to justify traffic lights or to pose any real danger to a bunch of kids engrossed in a game of street football. Pep would play before going to school, on his way home from school. He'd take the ball everywhere to have a kickabout at break time, at lunchtime, in the cobbled streets, around the fountains. He was even known to practice football during family dinners, and his mother would tire of berating him. Leave the ball alone for 5 minutes and get yourself over here. Like so many kids and so many mothers in towns and villages all over the world. Back then, everything was much more relaxed. There was less protocol, less bureaucracy, as Guardiola puts it. You'd go down to the square with a football and you'd play until it was too dark to see the ball. It was that simple. You didn't need to go to a proper pitch or organise matches, nor set a time to play. There were no goalposts or nets, and nor were there signs warning kids that they couldn't play ball games either. A metal garage door served as the goal, and there were always arguments over who would be the keeper. Pilar never wanted to be the goalie. She had quite a kick and a good first touch, and for more than a decade, the women's team in a neighbouring village would enjoy the benefits of her hours of practice with Pep and the gang. There were always disputes about who got to have Pep in their team. The tactics were clear. Give him the ball so that he could control the game. All his friends were aware that he was better than the rest, that he had something that the others didn't have. In the end, to avoid arguments, it was decided that Pep would be the one to choose the two teams, so that they were of more or less equal ability. And it also meant that from an early age, without hesitation, Pep assumed his role as a leader. And when, in one of those street football games that might last the whole of Saturday or Sunday, one of the kids damaged something in the square with a wild shot, a smile from Pep would always get him and the rest of his friends out of trouble. Nowadays, cars can drive through the square and even park in the centre. It's no longer a place where kids can play. When Pep returned to Barcelona to coach the reserve team, brief getaways to Sant Pedor and long walks in the surrounding countryside became a regular occurrence. Reflective to the point of bordering on meditation, Pep also made numerous trips to his village when he was debating about making the jump from the reserves to the first team. Although it was hardly seen during the 4 years that he was changing the football world as coach of the best team on the planet, his presence is felt in various corners of the village. The football stadium bears his name. His photograph adorns several bars. There is a plaque on a stone in the centre of the square dedicated to FC Barcelona by the local supporters club, which, by the way, has gained 100 additional members in the past 4 years. The popularity of grassroots football has grown to such an extent that the handball teams have dwindled. The children from the village only want to play football, and they will proudly tell you that they are from Pep Guardiola's village, Sant Pedor. So there's a bit of Pep in Sant Pedor, but there's also clearly a lot of Sant Pedor in Pep. The whispered conversations you hear around here are in Catalan, along with signs and street names. The Senyera, the Catalan flag, hangs from many balconies, and graffiti on several abandoned buildings echo people's sentiments for their nation and their strong sense of Catalan identity. The village even had the honour of being named Carrer de Barcelona, a medieval Catalan distinction with all the privileges and taxes that came with it. Sant Pedor was a road to Barcelona, the capital of Catalonia and Guardiola's life-changing destination. Pep is a very proud Catalan, an educated and courteous individual. He takes after his parents, the Guardiolas and the Salas, who are like any other parents in the village, modest and respectable. They sowed the seed, or was it sown originally by Saint Pedor? Pep's friend, David Trueber, thinks both of them did. Nobody has paid any attention to the fundamental fact that Guardiola is a bricklayer's son. For Pep, his father Valenti is an example of integrity and hard work. The family he has grown up with in Saint Pedor has instilled old values in him. Values from a time in which parents didn't have money or property to hand down to their children. Just dignity and principles. When it comes to analysing or judging Guardiola, you must bear in mind the fact that underneath the elegant suit, the cashmere jumper and the tie is the son of a bricklayer. Inside those expensive Italian shoes, there is a heart in espadrilles. When Pep thinks back to his childhood in the village, to his parents, to the long games in the square, he doesn't recall a specific moment, but a feeling, happiness, joy in its purest, most simple form. And that sensation comes back to him whenever he returns to visit his parents, or his Auntie Carmen, or Uncle Jose, or any of the relatives still living in Saint Pedor, and sits with them in the village square until a legion of admirers gate crashes his privacy and the moment is lost. Back when he was a kid and the sun had set on that village square, the young Pep would head home and set the ball in a corner of his bedroom, a modest space decorated by little more than a poster featuring Michel Platini, the face of football when Guardiola was 10 years old. Guardiola had never seen him play. In those days, television did not show much international football. But he had heard his dad and granddad talk about the ability of the Juventus player, his leadership and his aura. All that Pep knew about Platini were those wise words of his elders, and that poster of the elegant Frenchman, caressing the ball, head up, surveying the pitch, and picking his next pass. The attraction was instant. 5 years later, a young Camp Nou ball boy named Pep Guardiola would earnestly try to get Platini's autograph at the end of a match. But in failing, he ended up learning a key lesson. That story will be told later. A good student in his days at the village convent school, Pep was known as a tros de pa, a bit of bread, as they say in Catalan, a well-behaved child, soaking up knowledge, always willing to help in church. Just about the closest Guardi came to rebellion was disappearing early on the odd occasion his dad asked him to help out with some bricklaying. He always looked as if butter wouldn't melt in his mouth, an asset on the occasions he was asked to play the role of an angel in the village nativity plays. Pep moved to a Catholic school a few miles from home, La Sala de Manresa, when he was 7, his first exodus. It was a strict environment, and he had to adapt quickly to his new surroundings and teachers. Brother Virgilio was responsible for teaching him his first words in English, a language he now switches to with ease whenever questioned at a Champions League press conference in front of the world's media, as well as Italian and, of course, Catalan and Spanish. Oh, and French too. At La Sala, his personality traits continually emerged and developed. Self-demanding, blessed with a natural charm, and obsessed with football. But above all else, Pep proved to be an excellent listener, and, like a sponge, absorbed knowledge from everyone around him, especially his elders. He was a bit taller and thinner than most, perhaps a consequence of the fact that he never stood still, or so his mother thinks. And he was still the first player to be picked by the football captains and frequently the sole participant in one of his favourite games, keepy-uppy. He played that by himself because there was no point in competing. He couldn't be beaten. During one of those games at La Sala, he was spotted by a couple of scouts from Club Gymnastique de Manresa. The wiry lad's leadership and passing ability easily caught the eye. With the blessing of his dad, Valenti, he began training at Gymnastique 2 or 3 times a week, and some key principles were quickly instilled in him. Don't stamp on anybody, but don't let anybody stamp on you. Keep your head high. 2-touch football. Keep the ball on the ground. If the golden thread to success is coaching, Pep had started off in the ideal academy. Perhaps it was only natural that a kid from Pep's village would support Barcelona, considering there was only one fan of Espanyol, their rivals from across the city. That Espanyol fan also happened to be Pep's granddad, and there was even an Espanyol poster hanging on the walls of the family home in his honour. But his elder's preference didn't influence Pep's sporting allegiance. My granddad was the nicest person in the world and had such a huge heart that burst out of his chest. He had an enormous sense of compassion, so he almost felt compelled to support the smaller team, the underdog. In our village, there was not a single Espanyol fan apart from him. A teammate of his at Gymnastique had a relative who was a season ticket holder at FC Barcelona, and Pep asked him if he could borrow it to see a game at the Camp Nou one day. In 1981, a 10-year-old Pep set foot in the imposing stadium for the very first time to watch FC Barcelona take on Osasuna in La Liga. The street leading up to it was a river of people waving Barcelona flags, and Pep experienced an incredible feeling of joy, of excitement, of being a part of something big, an epiphany. As he sat in row 7 of the north stand, just off to one side behind the goal, he muttered to his friend, as thousands of kids before him must have done, "I would pay millions to play on that pitch one day." In fact, while he was with Gymnastique, Pep played in a few friendlies against the FC Barcelona academy sides, which provided him with some valuable lessons regarding his own and his team's limitations. He was the best player in that Gymnastique side, but he sensed there were many more kids like him, or even better, wearing the blue and red shirt of FC Barcelona. It was around this time, and without his 11-year-old son knowing it, that Valenti filled in a form published in a sports paper offering kids the opportunity to take part in trials organised by Barça. "Barcelona want to see you," his dad told him a few days later, to his son's amazement. Of course, he went to the trial. Nervous, still very lightweight. He played badly, and he knew it. A sleepless night followed. He was asked to return for a second day, but he was no better. At the trial, Pep was played in an attacking wide position, and he lacked the pace and strength to excel. He was given one more chance, invited back for a third day. The coach moved him into central midfield, where, suddenly, Pep was a magnet for the ball, directing the forward play and dictating tempo. He'd done enough. Barcelona decided they wanted him to join them. His dad kept that information to himself until he was sure it was in his son's best interests. Valenti and Pep's mum, Dolores, were worried that those daunting and stressful trips to Barcelona were unnerving their son, who returned home quieter than usual, apprehensive and unable to eat properly. After discussing it with his wife, Valenti decided to reject Barcelona's offer. They believed that Pep was too young to move to La Masia, too naive to live on his own away from his family, not yet strong enough to compete or to cope. In the years following that trial with Barcelona, football remained a key part of the Guardiola family routine, with constant trips to Manresa and throughout the region for league games and friendlies, with Pep promoted to captain of the Gymnastique side. The dream of Barça, it seemed, had been forgotten. A couple of years later, FC Barcelona made another phone call to the Guardiola household. Valenti picked up the receiver and listened to their offer. "We have to talk," he told his son after a training session with Gymnastique. The family gathered round the dinner table, Valenti, Dolores and their 13-year-old son, Pep. Dad tried to explain as best he could to a young teenage boy that there was life beyond the village and the Catholic school. He tried to prepare him for what he should expect if he left home, that his studies were a priority, that a move to Barcelona would expose Pep to an entirely new level of obligations, responsibility and expectation. Up until that moment in Pep's life, football had been little more than a game. But, as Valenti told his son, he now had the opportunity to transform his life and make a living out of the sport he loved at the club he adored. Pep took his father's words on board and understood what was at stake. He had already made up his mind that if Barcelona didn't come back for him, he would abandon his dream of becoming a professional footballer because he couldn't take any further rejection. But Barça had called. The decision was made. Pep Guardiola was going to leave home and all that was familiar behind him. He was going to move to the big city. He was going to give his all to become a professional footballer. He was going to pursue his dream of playing for FC Barcelona. A kid jumping on a bunk bed in La Masia, Barcelona. An early August evening, late 1980s. Soon after receiving the call, Pep, together with his parents and brother Pere, visited Barcelona's facilities at La Masia, the old farm that housed the young academy players from outside Barcelona. Lying on top of one of the bunk beds, Pep opened the window of the room he would share with four other lads and could barely contain his excitement as he shouted, "Wow, Mum, look! Every day I'll be able to open this window and see the Nou Camp." When he moved to La Masia, he left behind the Platini poster that adorned his room. Consciously or not, football had moved into another dimension. Yet for Pep, it was still a game. He doesn't look back on his early days at the club as a time of emotional hardship, although he admits it was difficult to leave behind everything he knew, including all his friends, at just 13 years old. From one day to the next, family ties were broken. New relationships had to be forged. Occasionally at night he would go down to the ground floor of the old farmhouse to use the payphone to chat with his parents. But unlike many of the kids who suffered terrible homesickness because of the distances separating them from their families, Pep's calls were less frequent because most weekends he would return to his village just an hour away. He describes it now as an eye-opening time, full of novelties and discoveries and some absences that helped him mature. He grew up and developed quickly. The distance separating him and his teammates from family and friends was going to make them resilient. His father doesn't remember it like that. The lad phoned us up in tears. He used to break our hearts. Memory likes to play tricks. His life as a manager, tense, exhausting, created a curious effect. His young life seems to have been rewritten, and Pep has started to look back on those days with a mixture of melancholy and envy for the lost innocence of it all. Clearly, he has now forgotten the most painful parts, the good memories blotting out the bad. But a decade ago, he wrote that he sometimes felt helpless at the big house, which is how the Barça headquarters was known to the kids. The club had given him and the other youngsters everything they required, but especially the affection and peace of mind to know that whenever I needed them, they were always nearby to stop my problems getting in the way of my dreams. And that fact that they're there for us is so important to me that I'll always be grateful to them, and I'll never be able to repay them. Their day started with a breakfast that consisted of yogurts, cereals, toast, jam and milk. Unlike other kids of their generation, the youngsters at La Masia shared a television with an automatic timer that clicked off at 11 o'clock every night. Apart from daily training sessions, there were distractions far more eye-opening than anything their TV was showing before the watershed. After dark and despite the curfew, Pep and his roommates would gather at the window to be entertained by one of the rituals of the residence, spying on the nightly comings and goings of the prostitutes who plied their trade up and down the street that leads to the gates of La Masia. With time, their presence became part of the furniture. The bedtime tears of some of the kids also became a part of the nightly soundtrack. But Pep quickly grasped that crying didn't make him feel any better. They were living the dream after all. Far better to focus on the job in hand, which in his case included a program of physical improvement, as his mentors could see the potential, but were worried about his slight frame. He talked and talked football during the long coach journeys, travelling to games all over Catalonia, the homeland that he got to know so well in those teenage years. He continually learnt from everything he saw around him, from other teams, from coaches, from older teammates. On one occasion, he asked a couple of his colleagues to repeat a free kick routine he had seen the B-side perform the previous weekend. The move led to a goal, and their coach asked, "Whose idea was that? And where did you pick that up?" "From the grown-up players," responded a 15-year-old Pep Guardiola. La Masia, a footballing university campus where players and coaches mixed. The kids only want to play football, live football, and La Masia allows you to do it, Pep recalls. Any time of day was ideal to get a ball and have a kick about, or to go and see how the others trained. Occasionally, when I'm asked to do a talk in La Masia, I use the following example. Each night, when you are going to sleep, ask yourselves if you like football or not. Ask yourselves if right then you'd get up, grab the ball and play for a bit. If ever the answer is no, then that is the day you start looking for something else to do. There were other benefits to living in the football school. The Masia kids had the opportunity to become privileged spectators in the Nou Camp by handing out club leaflets on match days or, after a long waiting list, becoming ball boys. There is a picture of a young Pep on the pitch, gleefully clapping alongside a couple of Barcelona players with Terry Venables, carried aloft on their shoulders, in celebration after the final whistle the night FC Barcelona beat Gothenburg to reach the European Cup final in 1986. Pep learned an unexpected lesson as a ball boy when the teenager waited for his idol, Michel Platini, to come out for the warm-up before a Barcelona-Juventus game. He had been dreaming about it for weeks, his first chance to see his childhood hero in the flesh, and he had a cunning plan to secure Platini's autograph. Pen and paper tucked away in his pocket, Pep planned to pounce on the French star as he walked across the pitch to join his teammates in the warm-up on the far side. He knew it was the only chance he was going to get without getting into trouble. Cabrini, Bonini, Brio jogged out, then Michel Laudrup, but no Platini. It transpired that the French superstar didn't always come out with the team to do some stretching. Ah, Pep thought, so not all players are treated as equals. It turns out they're not all the same. The pen and paper stayed in his pocket, unused. The Platini poster that hadn't accompanied him to La Masia stayed on the wall of his bedroom in Saint Pedor for a few years, but gradually another player, this one far more accessible, took centre stage. Guillermo Amor, future midfielder of the Johan Cruyff side, 4 years older than Pep and also resident at La Masia. "At the time when I started to pay attention to everything that you did, I was 13 years old," Pep wrote a decade ago in reference to Amor in his autobiography, My People, My Football. "I didn't just follow every one of your games, but also the training sessions. I paid attention to your attitude, because you faced everyone as if your life depended on it. I used to have my practical football lessons at 7 p.m. on an adjacent pitch, but I used to turn up 2 hours earlier so I could listen in on the theory class on pitch number one. Seeing how you carried yourself, how you encouraged your teammates, how you asked for the ball, how you listened and how you earned the respect of everyone around you, I pay tribute to you today for every one of those moments you gave us, back then at La Masia on pitch number one, during mealtimes, in the dressing room, throughout the holidays, away at hotels, and even on television. When Amor returned from away games with the B team, a side that also included Tito Villanova, Pep's future assistant and successor in the Camp Nou dugout, Guardiola would pester him for the score and details of how they'd got along. "We won," would be the standard answer. Over the next few years, Amor, who embodied all the values instilled in players at the club right through to the first team, became like a big brother to Pep, who intuitively understood that the club is not only about the bricks and mortar of the stadium or training facility, but mostly about the footballing DNA shared by Guillermo and others like him. So when Pep took his first major decisions as a Barcelona manager, selling Ronaldinho and Deco or approving Amor's appointment as director of youth football, he did so with a desire to return the focus of influence in the dressing room to homegrown players. Guardiola remained a lanky teenager with little muscle mass, the opposite of the ideal footballer's stature. But great art is always born of frustration, and since he lacked the pace and strength to overcome the opposition, he substituted physical power with the power of the mind, instinctively developing a sense of spatial awareness that was second to none. He was capable of leaving behind three players with one pass, widening or narrowing the field at will, so that the ball always travelled more than the player. Usually, when children start to play football, they want to learn to dribble. Guardiola didn't. He learnt how to pass the ball. La Masia, a word also used to generically describe the Barcelona youth system, was and still is rich in talent. The product of promoting, for more than three decades, a style of football now celebrated around the world. Some think it is like the Coca-Cola recipe, says the Catalan journalist Ramon Bessa, some sort of secret winning formula. In fact, it's no secret at all. It is, simultaneously, a simple yet revolutionary idea. Possession, combining, defending by attacking, and always looking for a way to the opposition goal. Finding the best talent without physical restrictions as the key element of the selection of players. Add to that the commitment to technical quality and ensuring that the kids develop an understanding of the game. It is a philosophy based on technique and talent. Nothing more, nothing less. I have never forgotten the first thing they told me when I came to Barca as a little boy, says the Barcelona midfielder Xavi Hernandez. Here, you can never give the ball away. The Barcelona model is the consequence of a club that always favoured good football. In the 1950s, the Catalan club recruited the Hungarians Ladislao Kubala, Xandor Kocsis and Zoltán Csibor, key members of the best national team in the world at that time, and also of the revolutionary ideas brought to the club by two men, Laureano Ruiz and Johan Cruyff. Laureano was a stubborn coach who, in the 1970s, introduced a particular brand of training to Barcelona based upon talent and technique, and by his second season at the club had managed to convince all the junior teams to follow suit. Under Cruyff, dominating the ball became the first and most important rule. If you have the ball, the opposition doesn't have it and can't attack you, Cruyff would repeat daily. So the job became finding the players who could keep possession and also doing a lot of positional work in training. On top of that, La Masia, as all good academies should, develops players and human beings and instills in them a strong sense of belonging, of identity. As Xavi explains, what is the key to this Barcelona? That the majority of us are from this house, from here. This is our team. But not just the players, the coaches too, the doctors, the physios, the handymen. We are all culés. We are all Barça fans. We're all a family. We're all united. We all go out of our way to make things work. Despite the fact that since 2011, the old farmhouse no longer serves as a hall of residence, the revolution that started there three decades ago continued and reached its zenith with the arrival of Guardiola as first-team coach, as he put his faith in La Masia's finest products. It is, as the Catalan sports writer and former Olympian Martí Perarnau puts it, a differentiating factor, an institutional flag, and a structural investment. And it is one that pays dividends as well. In 2010, it became the first youth academy to have trained all three finalists for the Ballon d'Or in the same year, with Andrés Iniesta, Lionel Messi, and Xavi Hernández standing side by side on the rostrum. I had the best years of my life at La Masia, Pep recalls. It was a time focused upon the singular, most non-negotiable dream that I have ever had, to play for Barca's first team. That anxiety to become good enough for Johan Cruyff to notice us cannot be put into words. Without that desire, none of us would be who we are today. Triumph is something else. I'm talking about loving football and being wanted. Even though Pep managed to overcome his lack of physical strength and got himself noticed, the final step was missing. The call-up to the first team. But when Johan Cruyff needed a number four, a player to direct the team in front of the defence, the Dutch coach wasn't deterred by Pep's slight physique. He called him up because he sensed that he could read the game and pass the ball. On that day in May 1989, Pep had to drop everything, including a girl he was just getting to know, grab his kit, and travel with the first team to a friendly in Banyoles. Suddenly, unexpectedly, he had made his senior Barcelona debut. He was 18 years old. If he'd hoped that the girl would be impressed with his new status, the same could not be said of Cruyff, who was distinctly underwhelmed by Pep's debut performance. "You are slower than my granny," the coach told him at half-time. But Pep grew to understand Cruyff's methods when it came to chastising his players. "When he attacked you most, and when you were at your worst, was when he helped you most. But since it was my first experience with a coach who was so important to me, that affected me enough for me never to forget it." Slower than my granny. Those words marked the beginning of one of the most enduring and influential football relationships in history. A training session. Now camp. Late morning, winter 1993. According to the principles Johan Cruyff introduced to Barcelona, coaches should lead by example. Play football. Be on the field during training and teach.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.